Welcome, I'm Dr. Mike Hansen, and I'm excited to share with you some pretty fascinating stuff that most people don't know, not only in this video, but in upcoming videos as well. Hippocrates was a Greek physician and philosopher from 400 BC, widely regarded as the father of medicine and for the physician's mantra of first, do no harm, as well as the greatest medicine of all is teaching people not to need it. And along those lines, if we could give every individual the right amount of nourishment and exercise, not too little, not too much, we would have the safest way to health. And now more and more studies are coming out that are confirming this to be true and underscoring the importance of nutrition and exercise and its role in preventing diseases and for optimizing physical and mental health. So that might not exactly be news to you, but the studies are honing in on the exact foods that we should be eating and why we should be eating them. With that said, there are a ton of misconceptions and misinformation that persists in this field, particularly about what constitutes a healthy diet. When there's so much deception out there, so much information that contradicts itself, fats are bad, fats are good, carbs are bad, carbs are good, and so on. What ends up happening is many people have unhealthy eating habits even when they're trying to eat healthy, or they think they're eating healthy. Also, the nutrient content of the food is not on most people's minds, neither is what's been done to the food. There are many important factors that go into the decision-making process when deciding on what you put inside your stomach. How accessible or convenient is it? What does it cost? Is it acceptable to the society that you live in? Is it familiar to you? Do you know how to cook it? Does it taste good? And last but not least, how much time does it take? Ultimately, unhealthy eating habits leads to chronic inflammation and chronic disease and people simply not feeling their best. In the short term, unhealthy food makes you feel lethargic. In the long term, it leads to things like metabolic syndrome, which goes hand in hand with type 2 diabetes, hypertension, high cholesterol, fatty liver disease, obesity, heart disease, even dementia and some types of cancer. It's also no coincidence that the biggest risk factors for having severe COVID illness, besides old age and being immunocompromised, it's diabetes, hypertension, obesity, basically those who are metabolically ill. In fact, of all the COVID patients I've seen in the ICU, all of them fit into one of these categories, meaning that they were metabolically ill at baseline, old, or immunocompromised. Of course, being vaccinated dramatically helps matters, but it's not 100%. And here is something that's very alarming to me. It's estimated that 88% of the US adult population is metabolically ill. The vast majority of adults are metabolically ill. And maybe someone who's not overweight thinks to themselves, well, that doesn't apply to me because I'm not overweight. But that's not necessarily the case because there's something called thin on the outside, fat on the inside. And they are, in fact, metabolically ill. Why are so many people metabolically ill? Well, metabolic syndrome happens when insulin resistance increases, and that happens when people eat unhealthy foods. Yes, exercise plays a role in that as well, and it's a big role, but it's not to the extent of nutrition. The unhealthy eating leads to fat being deposited in places that it doesn't belong, like the liver and inside of muscles. But what is healthy and unhealthy eating, and how do we truly know what's healthy or not? In order to answer that, we have to 1, define what nutrition is, 2, understand how nutrition studies are conducted, and 3, how to interpret a study. That's how we get to the truth. So let's start by defining some terms. Nutrition is a term that refers to the nutrients in foods they occur in, how the food is ingested, absorbed, and used in the body, and its effects in the body. Nutrients are categorized as macronutrients, micronutrients, fiber, and water. Macronutrients include carbohydrates, fats, and proteins, which provide energy to the body and are required in relatively large amounts. Their intake and expenditure are measured in terms of calories, which are units of energy. In comparison, micronutrients are required in much smaller amounts. We're talking vitamins and minerals required by the body. They don't provide energy, but are usually required for metabolic processes related to the body's use of the macronutrients. They also serve many other roles that are essential for normal body function.
Fiber doesn't get absorbed, so technically it's not classified as a nutrient, but it's super important for gut health and overall health, both the soluble fiber and the insoluble fiber.
Metabolism refers to the full range of biochemical processes that occur in living cells, including the body's use of nutrients. When you eat food, it's digested, meaning broken down into its smaller components, and then it gets absorbed across the cells of the digestive tract And eventually they make their way to your bloodstream, and then they get transported to various organs. And the first stop is the liver. The entire process involves complicated biochemical reactions. Bioavailability can be defined as the proportion of a nutrient that can be absorbed during digestion and used within the body. So certain nutrients have certain bioavailabilities, just like certain drugs have certain bioavailabilities. Macronutrients are typically highly bioavailable, meaning a large proportion of that nutrient is absorbed during digestion. Now, on the flip side, micronutrients, they have a much more variable bioavailability that depend on many factors. If you asked me, what is the most practical way to make sure that you eat enough quantities of all the required nutrients? My answer would be to eat a balanced mixture of mostly whole foods. So although the answer is easy, for most people, it's easier said than done. Public nutrition education, it's an ongoing challenge for many reasons. One website that is useful for this is the USDA's My Plate site, as well as this website. The basic food groups traditionally have been categorized as fruits, vegetables, grains, proteins, and dairy. In most classification systems, fats and oils are represented in a separate group based on the evolution of studies of fats and oils over the years. Some classifications have refined sugars as a separate group, or sometimes it's added to the group that includes fats and oils that fall under the umbrella of foods that should comprise a very small part of the diet. The food recommendations have been evolving as we learn more and more with new studies that come out. So advice on which types of food to eat, as well as the amount to be consumed from each group, has varied throughout history because of this. To further complicate matters, new fad diets, big companies, social media, misinformation, Netflix documentaries with an agenda, they can all leave us feeling more confused. We're told to avoid eating this or eat more of that, but we really need to separate the facts from fiction in order to know what we should put in our bodies. Two of the more common representations of the types and quantities of foods that should be consumed are the food pyramid and the more recent My Plate initiative. My general recommendation is this: avoid heavily processed foods, mostly because processing removes the fiber, especially the insoluble fiber in food, and most processed food has added sugar. And that's the core of the problem when we're talking about insulin resistance and thus metabolic syndrome. And balance is important too, because no one food or food group provides all the necessary nutrients. Personally, I try to stick with a Mediterranean or flexitarian diet, or as close to that as possible. So eating unprocessed food or minimally processed food that consists of whole intact grains, legumes, vegetables, fruits, nuts and seeds, as well as fish and chicken in a reasonable balance. That's the general rule of thumb. And drinking water, not soda or juice. 99% of people on this planet don't know how to properly analyze scientific studies because it takes time to learn how to understand all that science. And studies on nutrition are very complex because of the different types of studies, the reliability of the studies, and because there are so many variables that have to be accounted for before you can draw meaningful conclusions. But this is how we truly separate the facts from the fiction. So if that's something you're into, you're going to want to check out my upcoming videos where I go more in depth on that.